We're live now. Bias for action. Welcome back. Today we want to continue package hunting with GitLab and GitLab package hunter, because last week we found some resource issues, or maybe I was just too tired to do the right thing. And for like a short recap of what we wanted to actually achieve and have a quick introduction, I created some slides. I'm not planning to do a 1 hour live session with slides now, but I just want to like recap what is Package Hunter, why we want to use it and how it works in general, and also recap a little what we learned about Falco last week. And then we can go into trying it out, or maybe just switching it, because Niklas was so kind to prepare something which provisions Hetzner Cloud resources or Hetzner Cloud virtual machine with Terraform and brings a package hunter as a server. And then we can just push into specifically crafted malware and see how it goes. Just like speaking of that, the reason why we want to do it, oftentimes we have some recursive dependencies. We might not be knowing what else gets installed, which post-install scripts are being run. And there might be something which is actually being run in the post-install routine or in the package dependency, and this needs to be detected. And with current like package dependency scanning, you cannot really see if the package, for example, opens up a port or starts a download of a binary and then executes that, or even tries to read certain files on disk, which it is not allowed to do. And so when it tries to do that, we need to find a way to actually detect that. And it could also be coming from like abusing your CPU resources for example, for some Bitcoin mining and other stuff. So this is like Package Hunter came to life. And just to reiterate on that, it's like it installs the dependencies into a sandbox environment, which is a container. And then the syscalls are being monitored. And we are actually using Falco in the background to achieve that. So as we kind of learned last week, it's a cloud native runtime security project and helps detecting such behavior. Actually, it's being like used in Kubernetes clusters, and Pop showed us last week how to do that. I didn't edit the slide. Falco has a rule set engine, which allows you to actually define that in a rich DSL, and Package Hunter makes use of that, for example, to detect binaries being executed which are not allowed, to set config file access, process start spawning and listening on a port, inbound connections, outbound connections, and everything else which is not, for example, targeting rubygems.org or something else, or for Node.js, npm, whatever URL. And Falco communicates with Package Hunter. So you're uploading the tarball or the archive you want to check, spawns a Docker container, installs the dependencies, and so on. And there is an analysis ID being retrieved, and Falco does the background scanning, generates a report, and we can query it at a later point. That's basically the thing which is going on. And yeah, where the communication happens via an HTTP API. Our development server last week didn't use basic auth. By default, it's on. And there are different endpoints which can be used for npm as a package manager, yarn, bundler, and one for dependency specifically. There might be future endpoints being added for other dependency scanning or other dependency checks, but that's about it. The thing, how to use it, we started like using it on the CLI, and I also learned from Dennis how to not create a 2 gigabyte tarball for the GitLab archive, just removing some assets. Forgot to copy it on the slide now, but in the end, we are just interested in the source code and the dependencies being installed in the package and not by the riblobs, Git LFS, whatever data in the background. By using the CLI, we can actually like upload it, and we can also integrate it into CI/CD workflows by including a prepared template, a prepared container image, which contains the CLI, and then integrate it in our workflows. And I've also seen, or Dennis was so kind to send me the URL, the link, how GitLab actually does that for GitLab the product, GitLab the project, where this is being integrated into the CI/CD configuration, heavily using templates with extends and other things. But in the end, it's like uploading the GitLab tarball using Yarn and using Bundler, so Node.js and Ruby, and then parsing the report, and everything should be detected. Long story short, there are a couple of other resources available, like in the GitLab handbook for the application security team, how to investigate that as an example. The thing was, how can we actually test that? And one of the ideas we had last week, and this was not finished, we started to look into a specifically crafted demo repository, which has a package JSON. That's the thing I'm looking for. And the package JSON has a script section. It does a post install and tries to invoke a curl to an outbound connection to our website. And this should trigger Package Hunter to say, hey, this is not allowed. This is something malicious, even if it's a demo now. And we try to trigger it. In that regard, this should be finished by now. This brings me actually to the cloud provisioning. We talked about provisioning Package Hunter in the cloud. And one thing, and this is like I'm spoiling what Niklas will be showing in a bit. We wanted to provision what's inside the Vagrant file of Package Hunter, the Package Hunter project, and just install what is needed. I think it's in the main TF. Is it? No.
There's a cloud in it if you wrote user data. And then going down, I can explain it also afterwards. There's all the steps that we are doing. So
okay,
and then what we are doing, what are related.
I won't spoil you. Maybe I'll just hand it over to you. And you give us an introduction how it's working, provide the live access to the shell, and we get going from there. The general idea is to provision that automatically. We chose Hetzner Cloud because our past sessions have been based on Hetzner Cloud, but potentially you could just, with little adoptions, rewrite it to AWS or any other cloud provider. Okay, then I stop sharing my screen.
Okay, and I will take over. So I hope you can see everything. Okay, cool. Right, so, yeah. We come later to this part, or probably I can move it to another way. Let's make this bigger. Okay. And so first of all, let's get a little bit more overview. What is Package Hunter really doing? So in the end, so this is now a quick draw only. I will add some more colors to make it more understandable. So last week we had the introduction from Pop about Velcro and the Linux kernel, how it does with sysTrolls. And now we also get a little bit into Package Hunter. And in the end, what Package Hunter is really doing, it's instructs, it reads information from Velcro and also creates Docker container to execute some stuff. Why does it now read information from Velcro? Because every container that you spin up on a VM, it's like a kernel instruction. It's nothing special. It's a sysTrol, so nothing special from the fence side. And that's also the reason why Page Hunter is so beneficial. So you can use it with your typical technical stack. And probably that's really cool because you need only have a VM, an updated Linux kernel. Docker can be there. It can be also containerd. I need to check if there's Docker in or if it's only containerd. I didn't check that. So we will figure this also out. And Package Hunter gives us the information when the container is started. Afterwards, it will check the logs from Velcro, which sysTrols will be done, and then we get some information. About this information. Yeah, so let's keep in short what it does. So first of all, what I did already before, so that we don't need to bootstrap everything from scratch. So I created a small VM at Hetzner, what Michael said already. But I did it in a typical way. What we do here in everyone can contribute is to spin it up with Terraform and so on. Mostly, the main, this is not so interesting in terms of these are the standard Terraform instructions. So you create a server, and what's here not really new probably, we use here a typical tool that you can use in a cloud. It's called CloudInit. And CloudInit is for the boot up when you want to configure your machine dynamically, so for cloud instances. So in terms of you want to generating SSH keys on startup, you want to provide some packages on startup and so on. And for this CloudInit. And CloudInit is also, but this is not the CloudInit that I looked for. Wait. That's the CloudInit that I'm looking for. It comes from the cloud era a little bit, so to bootstrap your instance mostly. And you get then a cool YAML, probably because we are Kubernetes, we are already YAML engineers. Also for when you bootstrap a node in cloud environments, you have also YAML to describe your node, how it looks like. For example, you can provide users, you can say which packages should be installed, which files should be written, and so on. And I take the initial chance. So because in Package Hunter, we already have here the Vagrant files. So Vagrant is for your local setup. You want to bootstrap it. And here are a lot of instructions, what you need to do in terms of how to install Velcro, how to install Docker, how to install Node.js, everything what is for Package Hunter installed. So I did the same mostly in the cloud init. So I transferred it. So here we are creating the mount deal. So it's only for having a separate file. I'm starting to install Docker. I'm starting to install Velcro in the latest version, installing Node.js for Package Hunter because Package Hunter is currently written in Node.js, generating certificates for Velcro so that I can do a gRPC connection encrypted. And then I starting to fetching some rules in terms of that will help us to Velcro to determine when a malicious action will take place. Then afterwards, I instruct the kernel driver. So when we're looking back here, so Velcro loads currently here a small, can I make it a little bit better? So what we know here is, probably, it's been a few hours. I don't care. So probably the kernel consists of multiple modules, and so Velcro provides also its own module to do reading all the sysTrols. So that's mostly a module in a Linux kernel module is mostly a program in the kernel, so that can be executed or instructions that will be executed by the kernel directly. So also for Velcro there's a module, so this will be done literally by this line. So it will load into the module. Here we will save it that until we restart the VM, and then we are starting to check out the Package Hunter repository. I'm currently cloning not the official directory repository, I'm cloning directly the latest merge request that is currently open from Michael that already provide updates to support the latest version of Vulture. So 20.9 with gRPC, and so that we can use the latest version, because currently in the project, it uses a little bit older one, 20.3. I decided to check it out if it works, and it was working fine. So afterwards, I do some similar steps. So I checked it out. I copied the certificates for Package Hunter, because right now here, Package Hunter is currently doing a... How does it work in this way? Okay. So this is currently here a gRPC connection, and Vulture is currently here reading the module, and Package Hunter is also doing... Currently, I'm struggling a little bit with my diagram, and this speaking about the Docker separate API. So this is currently speaking to that, and that's the main reason. So afterwards, I checked out directly the repository, and we will come later into this part where we are checking the meldip, what this does is doing. So when we now going back into our terminal, I'm currently here seeing, you can see here the fresh instance that we created already from the Terraform code. So when we are looking back into the pipeline, you can see it's really fresh. I run it only 20 minutes ago. And so you see here all the information. So I get the IP address, and also Cloud Inner puts my SSH key onto that machine so that I can connect directly via SSH to the machine. So what we are now looking back. So first of all, what we now need to do. So the image is mostly done. You don't need to do any much special. So now we want to get to the point where we was last week to start Package Hunter. So for that, we can use the same commands. We will start Package Hunter in the development mode and debug packaging, and it should start up. You see now the running in development mode, authentication is disabled. There's currently a small bug in there. That's also reported in an issue. So authentication is not fully disabled because it's basic auth. It says something with the Express.js, what they're using. But I found out the way how you can use it. So there's a way to provide a user for that. So the user def with the password def can be used to getting, except it's in development mode, but sometimes says you need to authenticate, and this skips it mostly because def is anywhere in the code base hard-coded and you can use it. So that's the also the interesting point. So, but now you would see here that nothing is currently happening. We have no container created. We have these build image currently here, but we will come later to the image. What is this image is currently doing here? So now we have Package Hunter started. So the next part is now we need to find a project what has dependencies or security issues. So for that part, Michael was so kind and provided a cool malicious dependency. So we should see here in the package.json, it tries to do a post install, and that's not so cool. So what we need to do now is, now we need to get this binary, so this tar archive. And for that, I used a simple way last week. So you can use the target set from the repository, copying the link address, and then you're dropping it out to the YAML. It's also really fast. So here's our package. And now we need to upload this. So now we want to check our dependency against that. So for that, we need to use the curl command. And now let's check what's happening there. We need now to keep an eye more on the upper lane. So let's, okay. So what we now do is we're using this command to upload it, and we will look now on the output of the page hunter. And now we see that tag.
Can you increase the font size a little bit for the blind in the back, please?
That's better?
Yeah, better, thanks.
Okay, why is that not working? Last time it worked, let me check. Okay, now we're coming a little bit more further than we was last week. So we are here in the package hunter idea. We were having this, and let me think why this happened. Yeah, let's check out another project. Probably we'll use GitLab as example project, because this I also tested.
And since you mentioned the authorization bug, Dennis just wrote in the chat that he fixed it today, which is awesome.
Ah, cool. It was gitlab.org, right? So gitlab.
It's gitlab-org, gitlab, yes.
Let's try this project. No, I don't want to fetch it. Link address. So let's fetch it again. And let's start to upload it again.
That's a pretty nice download speed.
Yeah, luckily no one is working so that we can use so much, because it's a shared instance. Ah, now we could see. So it takes more time because the picture is a little bit better. And what it does in the end, it's now extracting all the files to a local directory. So we can also check it out, what's happening here. And now we need to wait. So you see, the request takes some time. We need to wait. And now it's coming to the interesting part. So it created a new container image, a new container of the image MolDep. And we will come later to the point when MolDep is taken. And now it started the container and executing all the commands in this. So in terms of is trying to build and checking now the package JSON in the need. So when there are dependencies. And you see now that he's now started the analyzing part. And now we're getting also an ID back. That's last time we didn't have the status OK. Now we have the status OK. And now he's doing, he checked for alert for container. So now the rules of Velcro also dropped in. So what he's really doing, he is trying to executing the all the layers and all the stuff. So, and when we check it now with Docker.ps, I think. Yeah, you see, it's currently starting a container from the image MolDep and currently doing a yarn install. So to check if there are any malicious dependencies in there. So we don't execute it directly on the machine. It will be executed in a container. And now we wait a little bit. So, and also funny is currently I don't use the big instance. So I use only an instance with 1 core and 2 GB of memory. So nothing big. So and checking out the GitLab main project to see if everything is working. And now we are mostly finished. Now let's wait. Okay. Now we need to run again 1,000 steps. Okay, 40,000 steps. This needs to be interesting. I think when we're now trying to get the results, let's check what's happening here. Was the cur command this ID? Ah, and now he's mostly passing all the stuff, and now we should get the information.
And you need the main URL and ID as a parameter, as a get URL
parameter. Is it so? Then I don't need to specify the front and drive.
I think so. So when you write the URL and then it's a question mark ID equals
I said it's a tree. Yeah. Okay. the tree.
So it's, yeah.
Now, oh, now we got it's a lot of information, but now let's structure it a little bit more. Yeah. So let's do it that way. And remove the verbals, so we don't need to check this all the results. And what? Last time I saw, I didn't have this in the cloud image. I need to add this. So pull requests are welcome to do that. And now we see all the information currently about what was happening. So these are the raw, mostly all the raw Falco information. What we currently can see here. So we have here what Gistro was be and mostly here it's interesting. So that he's currently saying, okay, yarn install probably that the connection is not allowed. And all the rules that we are currently have are provided by the package hunter repository. So I need to just I hate this every time. I didn't find this. Okay. So we have here the Falco rules. So these are the default ones that are provided by Package Hunter by itself. So I think this is the initial one. So it's only loading all the information which can be exchanged and which not. And we have special rules should be in the local, I think. Yeah, cool. And now here are the rules to see when, for example, a binary shouldn't be started or when a config will be opened or which a config file will be accessed from some processes. So every stuff that is currently done in the Falco installation will be now execute, and for example, it checks if it only goes to allowed destination. So, and the cool thing about this is, for example, you would run Package Hunter in your local instance or in your on-premise environment. You can also add your own destinations. For example, probably you are in an air-gapped environment, and you wouldn't allow to go to the NPM registry, and you want really to see what's happening in there. You can use it and restrict and make your process, your dependencies more secure in terms of that you can check every program of dependencies, what the dependencies are doing. So that's also for security and auto purpose. It's really great. And it's quite simple because you need only to have Docker on your instance. You need to have run Falco on your instance. And you need to have the Package Hunter running. And the Package Hunter has an API. But currently, it seems that it's not so feasible to run this via JQ. Now we need to do the experiment a little bit so that we now use the CLI. So this I didn't test it yet. So there's also a CLI directly. And probably then someone can look for a package that we want also to scan another one. So it has more vulnerabilities to see something. That would be also cool. But let's check where the CLI was because it was in some place. Ah, yeah. So the Package Hunter CLI is also written in the command. And let's check. We will do this way. So we will do all the local stuff because then we can fix it easier right now. And okay. Now, need to move this again.
What are you looking for?
Now I need to move my Zoom with Zoom sharing bar every time. I don't know how to attach to the left or right corner because it's sitting because I can't see when it's the my I had the bar in the bottom. So now I want to use the instead of we use the curl command, let's try to use the CLI. So I need to check what's the format to do that.
You mean the CLI.js? You can use what is written in the GitLab CI configuration. Yeah. I've sent it to you in Discord.
Yeah, exactly. If you copy that, it probably should work.
Do I need to copy some certs, something like that?
No, here you just need to, I think I renamed this environment variables to just package hunter user and package hunter bus. I see I forgot to mention that there. Let me quickly check. Yeah, try it like this and see if this works.
Right. Wait, we will switch to the beginning.
So the CI template has some variables defined which are using HTI user, and they are reading the environment variables package hunter user and so on.
Nothing happened. Ah, okay, nothing happens because I can't. Okay, the bread's currently is in my shell.
Yeah, I think you can remove the. You can remove exactly.
And now we have a unauthorized. Okay, and you said it's now renamed, right? So I think that would be the case.
Yeah, maybe try to use a package hunter. All caps package underscore hunter
and also pass. Okay,
I think that was also caps.
It should be caps
to be coming.
Yeah, I need to update the readme instructions.
I will send afterwards pull request.
Oh, awesome! Thank you.
So we have it.
Pass so probably also caps. Time. Yeah.
Nope. Let's dive shortly in the code. No problem.
Yeah, that's the power of open source. You can actually read it and reverse engineer it.
Sadly, it doesn't found it. Okay.
Maybe remove the underscore to get a more generic set of results.
Here we readme that. And here we need to check the JS.
I think the CI template
remaps the variables. It's written underscore. It's written with underscore, I think, with smaller case assumption. Because I read about prefix. This RC. Yeah, it's the prefix. This is the package. So this is a node package where you can easily configure your applications to have it in a convenient path. And then I think...
I think if you do a git blame on that line, that was renamed because I remember this being something else.
Okay, I do that from.
But if you use package hunter underscore. Maybe not. Maybe I was wrong.
Yeah, it's correct. You see, we have in here the HTR. For hunter and now it's drop package hunter. So I think this will be only
package underscore hunter underscore pass all in lowercase.
Yeah. Or we can also make a pull case to make it uppercase. So then it's also convenient to
yeah, it's more easy to discover this is an environment.
It's too fast.
Which file did they look at? Was it route.js? No.
CLI.js.
Ah, CLI. Ah, I'm in the wrong project, actually.
Ah, wait. Ah.
That's you also need to override this one.
Right, you also need to provide the host, correct? I forgot about that. So the reason why it's unauthorized is because you were reaching out to the default host, which is the one that GitLab uses in CI. And there we don't have, it has authentication turned on.
I think I did that last week or the time. So there will be some interesting audit logs on the server.
Now I have specified localhost.
Yeah, but I think you can override that from the CLI.
Right, you can override it from the CI. This is just a default value that is used if nothing else has been provided.
Yeah, but I didn't provide anything. So is it only host?
No, it's also package hunter host.
Package without an R.
We build a new project. No. Pretty sure host.
Maybe the host needs to be in uppercase.
No, it's written smaller case.
Ah. But is this the current version of it?
I clone the master.
Yeah, because the diff is something you figured out by git blame. This is an older version, I think.
Yeah, it's called host, and that's also what is now the name? Is it with? It's written in capital.
Maybe it's package hunter, which is in lowercase, then underscore, and then host in uppercase.
Oh, we can see also when it's working or not.
Another thing I learned is you can say debug is an asterisk and not just package asterisk. So you see everything, which is more verbose. At least. Didn't change much.
Yeah, but we can see he's trying to connect to this page, but then he's currently not reading these words. That's the problem here. So host was working, so let's check this way. Ta-da!
Repeat for me, what was the fix?
Uppercase user and uppercase pass. And now we need to understand why. Because it's the old one.
Yeah, but you should fix it later.
Yeah. But it takes time to execute in the same process. And so, because I think this variable is also here written in uppercase, and that's the convention from the package that is reduced here. So when you would write lowercase, then it would also read lowercase. I think because these are all in capital cases. So that's the reason why.
Yeah, thanks for live debugging.
No problem. That's our specialty, live debugging. We are really good at that. But yeah, we have a cool...
Oftentimes notation. We can actually fix it. Would you recommend to lowercase everything? Does that make sense?
No, uppercase. Uppercase because in bash scripts and mostly in all shell environments, it's every time uppercase and you prefix only. For example, it's package hunter, and then every now and then this variables will be read by that.
So the const conf require RC, the package hunter needs to be uppercased. If I understand this correctly in the code.
Yeah, that's it.
For context, I have the web IDE opened just now.
Now we see.
While this is still analyzing, I can quickly say a couple of words about the CLI.
Yeah, of course.
The main reason I implemented the CLI was because it's taking the output that you already showed before of package hunter, this huge Falco JSON file, and it's converts in something that we see here, which can be read by GitLab. So this will be displayed in the security dashboard exactly with this format parameter. It will change this JSON into GitLab format, and then you have it showing up in the security dashboard of GitLab, and you can from there on then triage any suspicious behavior and create issues and so on.
That's great. Now I understand why the JSON file in the CI template is called GL dependency scanning JSON. So you're actually outputting the same format as the current dependency scans.
Correct.
And this gets passed and it's magically integrated into GitLab. That's great.
Exactly.
Yeah, I had one problem. So what I didn't start it, because we have, it's like a client server, right? So I could also execute it here from my local machine. But the problem was that I can't reach the server. So I wasn't sure if it's on the Hetzner setup, so if something with firewall rules is run, or if it's the Node.js server that doesn't open a port on that, so that I can reach it from outside from localhost. So this was one problem that I had. So it's also the reason why we're currently testing it on the same instance, because that would be really cool to have it like in the CI/CD pipeline. I would have only the CLI, and then the rest will be taken in some server that's standing. So as a shared instance, because you don't want to spin up everything on that.
Yeah, exactly. This is how we use it in GitLab CI. Just the CLI, the small CI program is running for each CI job, which is calling out to a standalone server.
Yeah. And there's some debugging needed, so let's check. I will try to check something in the meantime. Ah, cool. So Michael can also use the page that you provided.
Which patch?
The package, the Twilio npm. Package.
Ah, package. Yeah, so for context, Dennis shared the Twilio npm blog post in the table with me, and thought it would be a good idea to just try it out.
They yeah, should have that afterwards. I think it's also them faster instead of staying. Currently, we're staying in the whole GitLab.com project for malicious code.
Yeah.
And probably some important note. When you would start on that, you need to have. Going back to the page hunter repository. Let's do it. Try taking on. Okay, yeah. So there's also a repository folder here in it's called Feltro test. And currently here's the Docker file in there. And this is currently for executing all your dependencies. So when you want, when you would get an error message that MailApp is not found, so this is the reason because you need also to build the MailApp image. I did this already in the repository directly. So you would see it when we're going back here. You would see I'm currently switching into the Feltro test folder. I'm building this image because Package Hunter currently requires one image. It's what is called MailApp to executing all the packages in there. And you have the freedom, for example, now you want to test complex packages that require small dependencies instead of the normal package hunter. So you have currently a lot of stuff in there. So you have bundler in there for the GitLab packages. And you see this image is a little bit longer. So you have Ruby in there, you have Golang in there, you have Git LFS, so Chrome, everything you need probably to build up a Ruby app or staying in a Ruby app or staying at least a Node.js app from house. So that's the other part. But now I think we have finished, right? Okay. It's looking like the format looks now a little bit different when we checked this, right? So it's not the old one. And we have it now in a better readable also for humans. And now, like Dennis said, when we would run this into, what is this render GIF? Which GIF? Where does it come from? Okay.
This is just some GIF that for the readme to show how the command line is being
used. Okay. I thought it would be also generated from the because I didn't spot it in the first part. So okay. And currently we see the same results here, a little bit more today. Yeah, and this will be presented then in the UI. Is this on which type of tier I can get the staining report? Is it directly in the free tier or do I need to have a upper tier for that, for getting the dependency staining report? Someone knows that?
I think dependency scanning needs an enterprise tier.
Okay. But
at least the... Well, the merge request integration and the security dashboard. The JSON is something you can also download as an artifact and manipulate by yourself.
Yeah, so probably getting an idea what you can also do there. So probably you, because it's already using Feltro and you can use this Feltro sidekick that we also discussed last week. So we could probably use this to ship all the logs, for example, into Loki or into Elasticsearch directly instead of shipping that you need to have it in GitLab or also in Grafana. I didn't check Grafana right out now. So currently at my company, we're using Loki for every logs that we get. And we're shipping also directly Feltro logs to Loki and to getting the reporting there to have it in a centralized place. And that could be also really cost efficient because Loki stores only into buckets and then you can easily parse it. And Feltro provides it a lot parsable, so you don't need to do many things. So that's also cool. But now let's get the last dependency for today. Let's repeat the action.
If you want to scan the Twilio one, this one is going to open reverse shell. I don't know if you updated the IP address or if you updated anything about the package. If not,
no, I fetched it directly. So what Winter sends me. Let's check what's happening here.
Okay. So, yeah, right. Connection refused. That's what I wanted to get to, because so it's opening a reverse shell to this IP that you are seeing there. And this is a server. This is my server. I can quickly open that port there. So what is happening as part of the installation of this dependency, that dependency will open a reverse shell to my private attacker controlled server and will let me execute arbitrary commands on your machine, essentially.
But only in a Docker container, right? Not on the full machine.
Yeah, exactly. Probably only in the...
Right now?
Yeah.
I probably should have asked first before sending the tarball. Sorry about that.
Michael, it's in your HDAW project. So when you get informed by Hetzen again, so that we're doing something malicious or unsuspicious, and the BSI calls you, so you know there was a reason.
I'm still getting emails about some Kubernetes UDP ports which are opened, yes.
Yeah, we need to shut down the clusters.
Interesting.
Let me know, Dennis, when I should open it.
Generating work for Dennis now. Not happy.
In fact, actually, if you just open that that archive and just change the IP to your own local instance there, we could make the reverse shell call into your server.
And yeah, let's do that.
And then we have the full demo. Yeah, there's just one file. It's just a package JSON.
Oh, it's under package. Okay. Yeah.
Exactly. And here you just essentially need to change the IP here, 46, something to your own IP.
But this works only on IPv4. So would you have IPv6? You're probably currently more secure, right? So we just... Okay.
Don't spoil it. Microsoft needed to patch something with IPv6 remote code execution last week.
And now I need Vitagurus, because now it's CVF.
Yeah, I think so.
You want to create something. Yeah.
Hmm?
You need to, the first parameter is the tarball, and the second one is the directory.
Okay. Okay. So let's... Where's my command?
And before you start the analyze job again, you should just open with netcat, open a port.
Okay. Yeah, let's check first where I have my command, so then we can... I have only 10 history. Huh? Where is it? Why is it here? Okay, too many panes open. So let's, do we need this? No, let's close this one. So netcat and then 8080.
I just posted the NC command. It has a couple of command line switches too. I don't know if you can see it.
/nlvp.
Yeah, I copied it directly, but it's not working. So do I need, probably because I have multiple interface, do I need to specify the interface or which address it should be used?
Probably. I think it's -i.
Could, or maybe it's missing the fact that it's localhost because it's complaining get address and full for host. And I mean, this is not the host, these are the parameters. So maybe you need to just say localhost colon 8080. And the minus L is important for listening, otherwise
not. Oh, for listening, yeah.
It's not listening.
Now let's check.
Is the server still running?
Let me check. Ah, okay. I think this was the window of the server. Okay. Then we need to open another window. But let's make it more readable. Was it in this is also no. Okay. And the parameters. And here we need to start the development server again. So let's clear it a little bit up so everyone can see that it's happening. Okay, that doesn't work. Where's my command? Ah, no, I lost it in some bash history. Let me check again where it was.
Which command do you mean?
The command of triggering the CLI. But I think we can spin it up instead of now waiting. I have the alt curl command. We use that one, so it's the CLI is not so bit different. It's fine. Oh. Where's my
So it's not complaining anymore that it connection refused. So okay, so might try to connect.
Okay.
So it looks like we probably need some more parameters at a netcat command.
Let's check first short. Probably.
I also think you listen on the wrong host. You listen to localhost and it tries to connect to another IP address than localhost.
Yeah. So and then how can I can I do the same literally with IP address?
Yes, I think so.
Let's open my fourth window with TCP dump.
But now, what will happen when I do this? trader check. Okay, I think it doesn't open. I think this could be now cloud provider specific a little bit, because I had also problems to open ports to external interfaces. So I think it could be some firewalls that are currently taking in place, because I think, yeah, you see, it's currently open here on the port.
You can also try to use Netcat with the dash V parameter. Then you will receive a short message if for an incoming connection. So, yes. Mm.
No. Okay, that could be now really cloud provider specific, because
maybe they have the firewall.
Yeah, but luckily it goes outside, right? So and it's not cloud.
Does the Ubuntu virtual machine have a default firewall enabled?
I don't know. I didn't. Ah, it could be also a case. I didn't check that. Let's check this. So probably there's some UFV or something like that. So because last time I configured it directly here on the Package Hunter host, and it was not working, but they have said that there was no firewall applied.
Yeah, sometimes the UFV is enabled in cloud images by cloud providers, and I think in the raw installation of Ubuntu you don't have it, but I'm not sure. I have no. How can you list it?
UFV, what you status? Otherwise can try to do is to listen with Netcat on the Docker interface, so that your connection never leaves your system but stays internally.
That's, I think, stop. Was it stopped? Inactive. I think it was loaded. I didn't start. So let's try to do the same step again. So, yeah. Oh. Ah, and that was also my error to exposing Package Hunter. The UV, I didn't check that. Thanks for mentioning that.
Yeah, right. Now we got the incoming connection, and now we just need to tweak the parameters off and see a little bit that it doesn't close the connection immediately. And then what should be possible is that you just send shell commands via NC into the Package Hunter container.
No. This is now related. Issue. You know, I got it here, but I don't read it here.
It looks like NC already stopped now.
Yes, and NC exits after it receives a connection. So what you have to do is you need to use the minus K parameter to keep the connection open after an initial connect.
Yes. Okay. So, and I will upload the page again. And
need to submit the package again.
Yeah, I need to first initialize it. Okay. No, sorry. So or do I need to pipe it now to a special part? Yeah, probably you can do something like touching the file, right, to modify something. Oh, it's also no VR.
Cut or maybe less or something.
Let's remove it. Better. Now it's done. So when we now check into... Ah, now I got the flow. Oh, I deleted, what did I delete?
Package JSON.
There is an R missing at Docker.
And you see now my host would be compromised because and you see someone injected into my package and now can do everything what he wants to. So you can change at least file system. So sending out commands, I'm probably not capable of, but now we hijacked the whole session, so the whole host literally. But luckily, this is in a container, so nothing is really touched on my real host system. And that's quite cool.
Exactly. Probably, no. Just what I want to also make aware is that when you look at the package hunter window, there are also alerts now coming in. As you do strange stuff in the Docker container, now package hunter sends alerts out.
Ah, cool. And then I have an idea, so backwards from my old Docker days. So there's a really cool demo. I will share the link. But there's also Trio. Now we're getting a little bit more into the technical stuff. But Trio is for snapshotting containers, literally. So probably you would see an attack, and then you can snapshot the whole memory system and the whole CPU system of a container and see what's really happened there and restore it in another environment. So that would be really advanced and really cool to see this in live attack vectors, so to isolate your whole dependencies. And it's quite straightforward. It's really simple to get this up and running. So all the technologies are right out there. So you don't need to pay big products for that. So you can use it mostly. And getting a little bit more involved how this is currently working, that's really true. Yeah, that's some side notes on that. So to use that. Yeah, probably next time we could, pushing some ideas now back, probably it would be true to run it into Kubernetes using a virtual kubelet or like a micro VM only, what starts only a process and then snapshotting also the VM. So that would be also more advanced. So having a little bit easier scaling is right. So currently page hunter is only on a single host, so for a single instance, but then you can easily scale it out. So having multiple package hunters and then having a fleet of package hunters that tracking all, hunting all your dependencies. Yeah. So and then you can go on a right run. So on a wild, on a real hunt with a lot of dots and yeah, tracing all your dependencies.
Sounds interesting. You got yourself a new to-do.
Currently, I don't have so just much kidding. Time. I really like to dig into that.
Maybe, or at least I'm taking two weeks time PTO. So next week and in 2 weeks time, I don't have a session. But we can mix it up with learning Rust, Gitpod, Kubernetes, security, learning new things. And yeah, now I'm totally mind blown what's possible with the reverse shell. thanks for making my day. And also thanks for attending and live debugging. It was really nice. I tried to live tweet some things, and I also will be writing a short blog post as a recap, including all the URLs. Niklas looks like as he found out something new.
Now I understand now how the reverse shell is working. So I didn't check the command at first, and that's
I would say probably ops nightmare when someone sees that. But it's good that we have Package Hunter and all the amazing engineers who actually develop that stuff and also make it available for everyone. So I'm really looking forward how we can contribute to the project and also see it more being used in production to help prevent supply chain attacks and everything else which might be out there, something we probably don't know yet. But we can certainly help prevent it. Is there anything else you want to say in the end? Anyone? Anything missing?
Probably Dennis. Because he founded this awesome project, so yeah.
Nothing to say from my side except the awesome job. It's great to see I mean, you presented it better probably than I could have had presented it. So awesome job.
Thank you. Yeah. Looking forward to collaborate more in the future. So we might come back, or Niklas might be coming back earlier than we all think. No, just kidding again. It's always a pleasure to try out something new and also bring it like in a authentic way in the short presentation, diving into real life problems, debugging it, and everyone else can follow when they hopefully watch the recording later on. And yeah, from there, I would say thanks everyone for joining today. It was a real pleasure. I wish you a great time, and we will see each other in September again, at least for the Everyone Can Contribute Cafe. Yeah, and until then, I would just say bye-bye on you.